Thanks, Kevin. Okay, let's get right into it. So I'll do announcements at the very end. But hopefully you guys are following along with the Bible reading. So if you haven't, got into Bible reading, I would. So on the website, if you didn't know, under calendar, we've got the daily portion of Bible reading every day. And then every time we get to Sunday, that's what we read on Sundays. So if you didn't know that, you can go to the website. And then under calendar, there's a Google calendar there, and then every day there's a portion of scripture to read. And it amounts, like you see every Sunday, it amounts to about 3 chapters every day. It takes about 10 to 15 minutes. 15 minutes if you're a slow reader, 10 minutes if you're a fast reader. And if you just read a little bit every day, then every year you'll get through the Bible. If you have a phone or a tablet that you use, if you download Olive Tree, the Olive Tree Bible Study app, one of the reading plans in there is beginning to end, and that's pretty much the reading plan that I copied into that Google Calendar. So follow along if you can. Definitely for all believers, it's a good idea to get into the habit of reading your Bible every day. And just read. I just personally just read through it from beginning to end. I find that just easier than following some fancy plan that jumps around. But as a new believer, it's probably better if you start in the New Testament and then just go through it. And, as you read through it the first time, it'll be a bit difficult to pick up things. But as you read through it the second, third, and fourth time, you'll be amazed at how much more you pick up each time you go through the Bible. And that's just how you just learn a lot of the things that you didn't learn. The Holy Spirit just teaches you as you read the scriptures. So today, what I'm going to be preaching about, I'm going to Romans 15. 6. I'm going to be preaching on the topic of unity. So I just thought it was actually connected to the sermon that I preached a couple of weeks ago on the body and working together and teamwork. So part of that aspect is having unity within a church. Now, unity is different to peace, right? Because peace is just the absence of conflict. But you can have peace in a church, but that doesn't mean you necessarily have unity, right? So you might have peace within a church, but the underlying disunity eventually comes out, and then people realize, hey, we there wasn't actually peace. It was peace when there was no peace, in a sense. It wasn't true peace. There was just absence of conflict. There wasn't the peace that the Holy Spirit gives, and not that unity that God asks us to strive for. So what is unity? Have you ever played the game Uno? Uno is like you get to the last card. We all know what Uno means is one. So unity is when we are one, right? We are one mind. And I found this verse here in Romans 15:6. I thought it was a good sort of verse for unity. It says here that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that's the goal of any church, right? Of any church is to become, have unity. Like we have on our prayer list, to be simple, soul-winning, and united, so that we have this one mind, we believe the same thing, and we are going in the same direction, we have the same goals, and we have the same work that we are involved with. Now, we all have different personalities, right? So being unified and having unity doesn't mean that you all become the same person. So it's not, we all have different personalities, we all have different preferences, and that is allowed in unity. Because unity, you can have one goal, you can have one vision, you can have one doctrine, but that doesn't mean you have all the same preferences, you have all the same personalities. You're all exactly just, exactly like one another. And I think that's what a lot of churches strive to be. In terms of like they just have this what they call the cookie cutter method, where they just make everyone dress the same and act the same and have the same preferences, and if you're outside that mold, then you're worldly, you're ungodly, and whatever. As opposed to the one mind being the mind of Christ from the Bible, having that mind and yet there being different preferences and different personalities, different ways people can be, but that doesn't mean that you don't have unity. So how do we become unified in unity, right? We want to renew our minds to come back and be based on the scriptures. We'll go to a couple of verses here. Ephesians 4. Yeah. We see this concept about renewing our mind, right? Because one way we're going to become unified when we talk about having unity in a church, one big thing the Bible talks about is having this one mind, that we have this right perspective, and ultimately the right perspective comes from the Word of God, right? And that's why we have to renew our minds. If we are going to be unified in what we believe and how we think and the way we see things, we're all going to have to come back to this standard of the Word of God and change the world's philosophies and the things that the world teaches us, either it's from the world or from Satan, or it's from just traditions, just passed down from family to family and family. So when the Bible talks about renewing our mind, it's resetting all that and coming back to the scriptures and thinking, why do I think the way I think? Why do I believe the way I believe? We've got to bring it back to the scriptures. And if a church does that, we will have one mind, because we'll have this one standard that we're all building off, and we'll be able to discuss and settle things. So let's read from Ephesians 4. It says here that you put off concerning the former conversation. So conversation in the Bible is not what you say. Like we would say, you know, we're having a conversation. Conversation in the Bible is like your lifestyle. That's how the word is used. So it's like your former lifestyle, your former ways. Your former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. So we see here that our lusts are deceitful, aren't they? So things that feel good and things that we desire that are not necessarily right, they deceive us into thinking, oh, it's not that bad. You know, you go and do something that you shouldn't, and it's very deceitful because you think you're going to get pleasure out of this, but all you get is guilt, and all you get is a wrong relationship with God and lack of peace, lack of joy. It says here in verse 23, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. So this is the inner man, the new creature, the born again child of God. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath. And then we see some practical applications there of how we can put off the old man and put on the new man. But part of putting on the new man, and what we're focusing on today, is this renewing of your mind so that we can be in unity. And we see this concept as well in Romans 12. It says here, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. One thing I always heard about this verse is, you know, the problem with living sacrifices is they always crawl off the altar. You know, we as children of God, we are meant to present ourselves a sacrifice, all right? Something that is to use in order to serve and glorify and be pleasing to God. But they say the problem with a living sacrifice, because we don't get killed, right? We die spiritually, you know, die in a symbolic sense, right? We're dead to the flesh, but we're still alive. Like it says in Galatians 2:20, you know, we are dead, but yet we live, right? And the problem with being a living sacrifice is that we keep getting out of line, right? We keep crawling off the altar and going back to the world. Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So it's very reasonable that we serve God, right? Because of all the things God does for us, all the things God provides for us, how much He loves us and how much He puts up with us. Is it not reasonable that you serve God? And be not conformed to this world. So don't be the same as we see out in the world. And it's not just things that are in the world, like people say, oh, the internet's worldly because that came from the world. The world is as it's defined in James, right? The lust, John, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh and the pride of life. This is what it means by the world. It's the lust and the pride. And we don't want to be conformed to these things. We don't want to be like these things. But be transformed. So rather than conforming to the world, we want to be renewed, right? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So see, how do we transform how we live? We transform by the renewing of our mind. So it starts first with resetting your old ways, resetting the way you used to think, resetting it with the Word of God, being transformed by that, by what you've renewed in your mind. So that's how we're going to have this unity, is if we renew our minds, we have this one mind and one mouth glorifying our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let's go to 1 Corinthians. I'll show you here, 1 Corinthians 2. verse 9. Now there's two ways, and they're really kind of the same way because it's all sort of interlinked. But we'll read here in 1 Corinthians 2. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Now, you've probably heard this verse before, right? You've probably heard this verse, you know, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, nor entered in the heart of man what the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. And it's probably in the context of thinking about what you're going to get in heaven, right? That's probably where most people have heard this verse. And they think about, oh, you know, the things that God hath prepared for us in heaven, like we've never seen, we've never heard of. I don't know whether that's necessarily the case, because when we read on in verse 10, it says here, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. So it's not that in this world we are not able to know the things that God hath prepared for us. It's God has revealed them. He's revealed them through his Spirit. So now that we can know through the Word of God and through the Spirit of God. So in times past, it wasn't revealed. But now it has been revealed through his Spirit. And if we are born again, if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we through the Spirit of God can know these things. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? So it's saying, it's kind of like you only know yourself, right? Somebody else can't know your thoughts and your spirit. Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. But you see, God has given us of his Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit indwelling in us, and this is why we can know the things of God. Now, we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. So you see how it says, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, but it's in the past, right? It's not that it never has up until Jesus comes again. It's now that we've received the Spirit of God, we can hear. And we can understand these things, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. So see, there are words spoken by the Holy Ghost that reveal things to us which in time past had not been revealed, right? But it's only now that we have the Spirit of God that we are able to know these things. And as believers, this is how we become unified, right? Because the same Spirit is working in all of us, teaching us the words that the Holy Ghost teaches. And if we renew our mind and don't conform to the world, we can have this true unity that the Holy Ghost is preaching, that God seeks for the New Testament church. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So you see, spiritual truth and the Word of God, there is something spiritual that must happen. And it's like, it's not something that we can necessarily explain, you know, because it's a spiritual thing. But the Bible is teaching here that if somebody is not saved without some sort of influence by the Spirit of God, they are not able to understand the spiritual things of the Bible. You see, it says here, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. He says, they're foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, right? Because they're spiritually discerned. But then you think, well, but there are some unbelievers out there that do understand spiritual concepts. But I think the reason why that is because, you know, it's been preached to them. So the Holy Spirit has, in a sense, touched their lives. So they are able to understand the things that have been preached to them through the Holy Ghost. You know, and I think that's where that thing is. But if it was left to themselves, right, if it was just them in their unsafe state without the help of the Holy Ghost at all, they would not be able to understand anything of the Spirit of God. But us, without help from any man, like the Bible says in 1 John 2, you need not that any man teach you, because the anointing that it's in you is truth and is no lie, and it will continue to teach you. We, without any outside influence of any other person, are able to understand the things of God because we have the Holy Ghost in us teaching us. Whereas unsaved people, you know, I don't know all how God works, but it seems as though they are not able to understand things. And the only reason why maybe they can is because somehow they have, like Hebrews says, they've tasted of the heavenly gift. They can taste the things of God, but they don't have the Holy Spirit indwelling them constantly as a comforter teaching them. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. And look at this, for who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. So not only do we renew our mind, and hopefully we can unify all our minds to think the same way, but we have this mind of Christ. This is why we're even able to do that, right? This mind of Christ. And if we all, walk in the Spirit and strive for this unity, we will strive towards this mind of Christ and we will be closer to unity. So we see here in 1 Corinthians 2 that one way we get this unity is through the Spirit. And through the Spirit teaching us. And it's sort of intertwined as well, because the other way that we become unified, and I've sort of already talked about it, is through the Word of God, right? When we renew our mind to the Word of God. And these things are kind of interlinked. If you look here in John, I don't know if you've noticed this verse before, when Jesus is talking about the Comforter. It says here in John 16:13, "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth." So there's that Holy Spirit teaching us truth. But it says here, "For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come." So isn't it interesting here that when Jesus says, when he sends the Comforter does not come and speak of himself. He's not there to glorify himself. He's there to take of what Jesus has and then show it to you. "He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and show it unto you." So does the Holy Spirit come and glorify himself? No, the Holy Spirit comes as a Comforter, as a Spirit of truth, to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is why sometimes when you see the Pentecostal movement and the Holy Spirit coming and it's all about the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost does this. That's not the role of the Holy Ghost. The role of the Holy Ghost is not to come and glorify himself. The role of the Holy Ghost is to come and glorify Jesus Christ. "For he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine." So this is where the Trinity comes into the aspect now, where the Father is given to the Son and they are one, and the Holy Spirit speaks the word of Christ, which is also the Father's. "Therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you." So you see how it's all sort of intertwined, this Trinity, and even the way the Spirit works, where the Spirit speaks the word of God, but the Spirit is speaking the word of Christ. He's taking of Christ, and Jesus is the word of God, and it's all sort of interlinked, this Trinity. So even though we are taught by the Spirit of God, it's also the word of God that teaches us. And honestly, that's how I like to think of it. I don't think that the Spirit is only the Word of God, but in terms of how the Spirit manifests sometimes in this physical world, how do we know the Spirit is working? One way I like to think of it is the Word of God. When the Word of God is taught, the Word of God is in you, the Word of God influences, and that's sort of like how we can, in this physical world, see the manifestation of the Spirit. You know, Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." And even if you remember in John 3, I'll just go there. This isn't part of my sermon, but I don't know if you ever noticed this. Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Where is it here? That which is born of the flesh is flesh. So if you remember Jesus talking to Nicodemus here saying, you must be born again. In verse 6, he says, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." Look at this. "The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth." So it's saying you can hear the wind, but you can't see it, right? You can't see the wind, but you can hear the wind, and you can see how it affects people, but you can't see the wind itself. He says, "So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." So that's how I sort of like to think. It's like the Word of God. You can hear the Word of God and you can see its effect on people's lives and you can hear people speaking the Word of God. So it's like the wind moving things and moving and how it you can't see the wind itself, but its effects. And that's like the Word of God. You can hear the Word of God. You know, like faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. You can see how that changes people and its effect, but it's still not something that can be seen. Even these words on this page, I mean, that is not the Word of God. These are letters on a computer screen that represent how you would say the Word of God, but the speech itself is not seen, it's heard. All right, where was I? So we're taught through the Spirit and through the Word, And this is how we can get unity. Psalm 133 is a psalm on unity. And it's only three verses. It says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And you know what's interesting about this? See, the Bible doesn't just say that it's right to dwell in unity, which it is, obviously. Like, it's right for us to be unified and to strive for unity. But it says it's also pleasant. Because think about it, because not everything that is right to do is pleasant, is it? Do you know what I mean? So it, not everything that you ought to do is pleasant to do in a sense, because it takes faith sometimes to do it. Because if it weren't for the faith, you wouldn't do it naturally, because it's not pleasing to you to do it. But unity is pleasing. You know, think about it. Like, when you have peace with somebody, but you don't have unity, that's not necessarily pleasant, right? They're the sort of parties you don't really want to go to, because you're just there as peace, but you might have not, you know, have unity, because you need unity to have that sweet fellowship and that close fellowship. And that's what makes it pleasant. When you actually strive for unity and actually get there, it's really pleasing to you. It's enjoyable. And this is what this psalm is saying, how good and how pleasant is it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts of his garment. So what is that talking about? It's talking about the anointing oil when they were anointed and it flowed down. So it's saying that unity, and this is interesting, unity is like that oil that they were anointed with, and it flowed down the beard all the way down to the skirt. I don't know how that's pleasing. I mean, I wouldn't want to be covered with oil, but you know, I'm not saying, it's probably not saying that the experience is what's pleasant, but it's what that oil represents, right? The oil represented the anointing, which in the New Testament, we know that anointing, the anointing that you received of him, is the Holy Spirit. So the anointing, that oil that they anointed the priests with, was representative that they were anointed and fully covered, you know, with the Holy Spirit. So what I get from that is, I think it's interesting that one of the symbols of unity is the Holy Ghost. You know, this the oil that's representing the Holy Ghost. And it makes me think, is that one way that in a church it sort of reveals, is the Holy Spirit actually at work in this church? Do you know what I mean? If unity is represented by the oil and that's the Holy Spirit, maybe there's a link there that a church that is truly walking in the Spirit, that the Holy Spirit is among and is working in, there would be unity there, right? Because if the Holy Spirit is there, the Holy Spirit's going to be teaching, the Holy Spirit's going to be renewing people's minds, the Holy Spirit's going to help us walk in the Spirit, there's going to be unity, there's going to be love, and that is sort of like the outward manifestation of the Holy Spirit working within a church, that there is unity there amongst people. And if there is a church that does not have unity, they just have peace, you know, they just have the absence of conflict, but everyone's thinking different things and everyone has different frame of mind. There's a lot of disagreement in how, you know, what Bible to use and all this and all that. Then the Holy Spirit, I believe, it's like it's being hindered there. That's just one thought, if that oil represents unity. Let's look at verse 3. "As the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore." So is this dew like rain? You know, it's like the rain that comes, right? And like in Hebrew, it talks about, and the blessing, it waters the ground and then and the fruits bear from the ground. The rain is like that blessing from God. So another thing that unity is likened to is like the rain that is like that blessing. And what does it do? It brings forth life. It brings forth fruit, doesn't it? So again, I think this is another way it's like the Holy Spirit is manifesting in a church, is that when a church is bringing forth life, right? Because that unity is like that blessing that then gets everyone on the same page, that then gets everyone in the same mind, and then that then should result in bringing forth fruit, getting more people saved, getting people into the fold. Because when a church is divided, when a church doesn't have unity, the work is not as strong, right? Like we talked about last time with teamwork. When we all get involved in the work, then we're going to be more effective. The body then will work better and will bring forth life. So I think that's interesting there in Psalm 133. It talks about unity, talks about it being represented by the Holy Spirit, unity. But the other thing is also bringing forth life, bringing forth fruit. spiritual fruit, and that's getting people saved. Not only that, not only getting people saved, but also just the fruit in your life, like the fruit of the Spirit, the things you say, is the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in a church. So that's unity. Now, we ought to strive for unity. I don't think there's any, there's no confusion there, right? Obviously, unity is something that we ought to be striving for if it's a good thing. And not only is it right, but it's pleasant. So it's something you probably would want to strive for because it'll deepen the relationships. It'll make you more effective as a Christian and as part of the body. So we see here 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, brethren, farewell, be perfect, be of good comfort, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. Let's look at another one, Ephesians 4. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. So when we strive to live righteous, this is what God expects of us, right? He's saying that, you know, you're called, you're a child of God, and you're called to walk in the Spirit. And part of that is, a lot of these different factors. And one of these things is unity. With all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So you see there, we should be striving to be unified. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So you see, because there is only or one of all these, if we have the mind of Christ, we ought to be in unity. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? And I believe that's talking about Jesus going to hell and rising again. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. So that's Jesus going back to heaven. And now it goes on to what he's given the church. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. So these are the leaders in a church. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So this is the purpose. This is why it's important, you know, that leaders in a church have unity, because they will obviously affect the body of Christ, the rest of the church. And we see here that they should not only be unified in doctrine, so perfecting the saints and edifying the saints, but also in the work of the ministry. So we ought to have unity not only in doctrine, but also in work. Till we all come in the unity of the faith. So we continually teaching and preaching and working, striving to have unity. Because obviously we'll never have perfect unity until Jesus comes again. So we're constantly striving for that. And of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And look, see, there's safety in unity. There's safety in church leaders, you know, preaching and teaching the truth, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. And this is why you have to know the Bible. You have to know the Bible, and you have to study the Bible, because there are people out there to deceive you. You know, if you jump on YouTube, you jump on Google, like there's all sorts of doctrines out there. And you might listen to somebody and you think it's all good, but if you don't know the scriptures very well, there are people out there that are out there to deceive. They're cunning, they use, like, you know, it says here, the sleight of men, where they lie in wait to deceive. You know, Jesus talks about false prophets being wolves in sheep's clothing. You're not going to get online and a false prophet's not just going to tell you, hey, I'm a false prophet. You know, the YouTube channel is false prophet channel. You know, you get out there, you need to know the Bible so that you can judge these things. So when you hear these different sermons, you hear opinions of men, that you can judge it by the Word of God. But you need to know the Word of God to be able to do that. And this is one of the jobs of the preachers in church, is to preach the Bible, to preach the truth, to explain some of the doctrines and from the Word of God, so that you can be grounded and understand a few things and help you in your growth, so that you're not, like the Bible says here, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. Because when you don't know the Bible, everything sounds good. You know, everything has logic to it, but that doesn't mean it's true. You know, something can be logical. It's like Islam, right? Islam is very logical. You know, they can make logic of it, but it doesn't mean it's true because it goes against the Word of God. But speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So when it comes to speaking the truth, you see here it says speaking the truth in love. So it's not just what we say that matters, it's also how we say it that matters. You know, it's not just speaking the truth, it's speaking the truth in love. And it also means, see, because we have to speak the truth, preachers ought not to be fearful of speaking the truth. Like, how many people are fearful of saying things, you know, that, like how many churches you go to, they'll, on the Sunday morning, right, that's where they have the very shallow, very encouraging sermon, because that's when everyone's there. And then when they want to preach the deep and maybe the offensive and controversial things, that's always on the Wednesday night when nobody's there, right? On Wednesday night during the middle of the week when the diehards are there, they probably already know that stuff already. That's when they get into the nitty-gritty and go into the controversial stuff. But on the Sunday morning, when everybody's there, that's like when people come to church on the Sunday morning or on Sunday evening for us, they don't want to say those things. Why? Because they don't want to offend the new believers. They don't want to say these things. But the Bible says we ought to speak the truth. I mean, if they're preaching on a topic, hey, preach the whole counsel of God. You know, preach it all, because you may not get another chance to preach to those people. Because the people that come only on Sunday mornings, they don't go to Wednesday nights. They usually don't hang out, you know, with the church as much as everybody else. So that's the chance to infuse some truth into them. But it's also very important that we speak the truth in love. So it's not only what you say, but how you say it. And see, if we want to have unity, everybody needs to be there for the preaching, right? Like if something's preached in church and something's being taught, that's one way we get unity. This is one of the important things about preaching in a church. That's one of the important ministries, right, of the pulpit and preaching, is that when you preach and you teach the Word of God, it puts everybody on the same page. And businesses use this same practice as well. That's why they have post, you know, pre-thing briefing and then post-briefing, right, where they pull everyone together and they get everyone on the same page because it, why? Because it develops unity, doesn't it? That's why they do that. And that's why even now in my work, everything's about collaboration now, right? Everything's about, hey, you know, use all these tools because, you know, people are so used to like sending email here and having this conversation in this meeting room and this meeting room. Now everything's about collaboration. It's about having open platforms where, you know, conversations are had in the open now. Why? Because you don't have to have that conversation hundreds of times. The conversation is there on a thread and everyone can go see it and everyone's on the same page. Everyone has one mind. And this is one of the important things about preaching. You have everyone here, so everyone is on one mind. But how many churches take people away from the church, right? They take children out into children's church and they do things like that where they separate up the church, or they'll have like a conference and they'll preach on men's issues, but the women won't be there. And then they'll preach on women's issues and the women won't be there. I mean, if it's profitable for the men, it's profitable for the women, right? Because if it's coming from the Word of God, it's profitable for the men, it's profitable for the women, it's profitable for the children, it's profitable for the old, the young. It doesn't matter what culture you're from, what a country you're from. If it's from the Word of God, it's profitable to you. And if there is somebody that is, you know, you've gotten everyone together to hear some truth, why not keep them all together so that they're all on the same page and you can have unity in that church? So everyone has to be together for there to be unity. Now, I'm not against all these different programs, right? I mean, I think there is a place for them, but they ought not be at the same time as when the main preaching is going on. You know, there's preaching from the bishop of a church and he's teaching some truth, teaching things that he's learned from the Bible, and you're separating off children and things like that. They're not going to learn the same thing in that Sunday school or children's church as they'll learn sitting under the real preaching from the Bible. So we all have to be together to have that unity in doctrine, and it keeps us on the same page. Unity leads to stability and safety. And it's not only unity in doctrine, but also in work. Now, my last point is, and I sort of touched on this before, but let's go to 1 Peter 3, where I said you can have peace, right? But that doesn't mean you necessarily have unity. And one thing you'll see in the Bible where, and we'll read here first in 1 Peter 3, whenever you see unity being spoken about, often, very often, you'll see love as well, right? So we see here in 1 Peter 3. I'm just getting confused. Can you see that reference at the top there? It says 1 Peter 4, 1 to 3, 9. Why is that backwards? It says, finally, be ye all of one mind. So there's that one mind unity, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrarywise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. So we are called to unity, and that takes love. Why is that? Because you can have peace without love, can't you? Like a divorce. Like a divorce is peace without love. Yeah, because you have peace, you separate. And the same, churches can do the same. Like churches can split, people can separate, friends can separate. So you can have peace, but you can get peace without love, right? Because you just separate. But you can't get unity without love. Why? Because in order to have unity, you need to communicate with that person. You need to be with that person, first of all, right? You need to be in the same location. If you can't stand each other, then obviously, you know, you're not going to have unity. So physically, you need to be together, but also mentally, you need to be on one page. And because it requires, you know, humility, patience, communication, it requires love in order to have unity. And that's why, you know, we always see, you know, of one mind, you need love, because communication ultimately results in what? Conflict, right? And if we are not patient, we are not humble, we don't listen to one another, we don't love one another, we will never attain to unity. So unity requires interaction. You know, Amos 3:3, I won't go there, but can two walk together except they be agreed? So in order to agree on things, you need to communicate, and conflict will happen. And that's why it's very important that we resolve conflict the right way. And I won't go into that into this sermon, but Kevin preached on it before as well. But you know, in Matthew 18, where it talks about going to each other one-on-one if somebody has sinned against you, and it's usually the offended party goes to the offender. So, you know, usually we say, you know, they wronged me, they should come to me. Whereas the Bible actually teaches if somebody wrongs you, you go and try and make amends. And then there's a certain process in place to make up with people. But we ought to follow that. And see, that requires love. Right? Because if somebody's offended you and you just say, oh, whatever, you know, you write them off, you know, to hell with them, that's not loving, is it? Loving is when you actually try and resolve that. And only if you resolve it and you're willing to be patient and humble and all those sorts of things, that you will have unity with somebody else. So it requires love to attain unity, but it doesn't necessarily require love to have peace. But if you have unity, it will result in peace. So that's the sort of peace you want. You want peace that results from unity, as opposed to just peace, full stop. Philippians 2, this is the last chapter I'm ending on, with a few cross-references. Philippians 2, I believe, actually talks about unity, because this is what Paul is asking of the Philippians, that they would be unified. And then we see some examples of people that had those characteristics. It says here, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies. So if you know Philippians 1, he's just talked about all the tribulation that he's going through and all how hard it is to live for God and all that sort of stuff. So he goes into chapter 2 basically starting it saying, hey, isn't it hard enough? Isn't life hard enough? Right? Like, isn't it hard enough being a Christian that you're going to make it hard for your brothers and sisters in Christ? Do you know what I mean? So he's saying if there's any like consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if there's any reason to do these things, is sort of the idea I'm getting, because life is already so hard from the world, you know, you don't want to come to church and then it's hard as well, right? You go to the world and there's conflict, there's tribulation, there's persecution, there's no unity, and then you come to church and it's the same thing. You know, so you want to come to church and there is unity. You know, you want that pleasantness so that you can dwell, you know, with your brethren in unity, and it's going to require love. He says, fulfill you my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. So we see that unity is so important for the church to have that atmosphere, right? And it requires love. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. So we now see some practical ways of how we can achieve this unity. And it's all interlinked, obviously, with love. And we see this humbleness, right? This humility that it's not all about you. It's not about getting what you want. And this is one way, you know, you will try and understand others and have you this unity. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. So you see here that there's that humility that then, therefore, you will want what's best for somebody else as opposed to always getting what you want. Esteem other better than themselves. We'll just go to Rome, 1 Corinthians 10. This is another verse. See, let no man seek his own, but every man another's wealth. So see how we need to love one another. The other passage I wanted to show you is Romans 12:16, where it ties in this being humility with having achieving this unity. Be of the same mind one toward another, mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. So it's not that you speak condescending, like, you know, we would talk about it, but condescend means that you come down to that person's level, right? You come down and meet them. You are humble in order to understand them and be patient with them so that you can have that one mind. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So our ultimate example is Jesus Christ, right? Who being in the form of God. So Jesus, like, he's not just another man, like, he's God. So talk about condescending, right? Like, of all the people that condescended, he condescended from being, you know, the beginning and the end to coming down. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So he was God in the flesh, but made himself of no reputation. So he didn't come and set himself up as a king or as somebody rich, you know, like all these other false prophets. They always get power and women and money. What was Jesus? Jesus was poor. He could have chosen any family to be born into. And he chose a family of a poor family, right? Mary and Joseph. Made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And then it goes on, you know, wherefore God hath also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. So also before exaltation comes humility, right? That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now we'll just go down. I want to just show you a couple of other examples here. So we see the example of Christ, and then we see the example of Timothy. And again, we see these attributes of these people, right? Where they are humble, they are selfless, they care about, they esteem other better than themselves. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. So Paul, again, is writing to the Philippian church, right? He's talking about Timotheus. So Timotheus has not yet gone to Philippi, right? He's with Paul right now. But look what he says here. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. So you see how Timotheus here, that's his natural inclination, right? That he's caring about others. He's grown to the point where he doesn't have to just forcefully try and, okay, I better do something for somebody. He naturally wants to do that for the Philippians. Why? For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. So we see that this sort of personality is very unique, right? The people that are selfless and humble and care about others more than themselves, these is hard to come by, right? And even in Paul's day, he's saying, hey, I have no man like-minded. Like, Timothy's the only one with me that I can think of that naturally cares for you, because why? Everybody else is after their own wealth. They're all seeking their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. See, because when you're seeking your own, You're not seeking the things that are Jesus Christ. These are the opposites, right? You're either serving God or you're serving mammon. But ye know the proof of him, that as a son with the Father, he served with me in the gospel. Him therefore I hope to send presently, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. And I just want you to take note of that, that Timothy is helping Paul out, right, with the things that he needs. And Paul is saying here, I want to send Timotheus to you, but I got to see first how I'm doing, right? Because Timothy obviously plays a big part in helping Paul with the things that he's doing, because Paul is a lot older now. But I trust in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly. Yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor and fellow soldier, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants. So again, here we have Epaphroditus, who was somebody that helped Paul. But Epaphroditus in this instance has already been sent to Philippi, right? So he's already sent Epaphroditus to Philippi, as he's saying us, because he couldn't send Timothy. Timothy's with him. He wanted to send Timothy as well, but because he hasn't, he said, okay, well, it's necessary that I send somebody to you because he's looking out for the Philippians. So he sent Epaphroditus, right? He that ministered to my wants. So again, he sent somebody that is helping him as well to the things that he needs. For he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because that ye had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick, nigh unto death. But God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. So Epaphroditus was not somebody that was well. He was somebody that was sick, but he was sent by Paul to go and help the Philippians because that's what Paul believed that they needed. I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when you see him again, you may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation. So we ought not to be holding, you know, people who are famous and rich and powerful and wise in reputation. God is saying here, it's the people that are humble, that are serving the Lord, that are being selfless, that are giving up, and that are esteeming others better than themselves. These are the people we ought to be holding in such in reputation. You know, not people who are just, you know, very skilled or very wise, very powerful, very rich. No. These are the sort of people that God wants us to hold in reputation. Why? Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. So isn't that interesting? So we see here, we saw the example of Christ, how he was selfless. We saw the example of Timotheus. We saw the example of Epaphroditus. But even Paul as well is an example here, because what the Philippians, he's saying that the Philippians were obligated to do something for him, but they weren't, and it was Epaphroditus that was picking up that slack. But even though the Philippians were lacking in their service towards Paul, Paul still cared about them. He still esteemed them better than himself, sending ministers that were helping him, Epaphroditus and Timotheus, to go help a church that was lacking in service of something that they were meant to be doing for him. What love these people have, what selflessness. These are the people we ought to be holding in reputation and that God recognizes. And this is what we ought to be striving for. We ought to be striving to be people like this. We shouldn't be striving to be the Philippians in this example. You know, where we're lacking in service, we want to be the Timotheus, the Epaphroditus, the Paul. You know, obviously Jesus is our main goal. But we see here as well that, see, when we lack in our service, somebody's got to pick up that slack, don't they? So it's not that the Philippians were lacking in service and there was no problem. No, Epaphroditus picked up the slack that the Philippians didn't do. And it's like that in every course of work. And it's the same like that in the spiritual work. You know, the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. And when there are less laborers, it's more work for the people that are doing the labor than it is if more people were doing the work, because they not only have to do the work that God has called them to do, but they are picking up the slack of the service that Christians, that God has called you to do something, you know, they've got to pick up that slack. Now, the thought I just want to finish on as well is, I don't know if you noticed here, but you know how when he says here about Timothy, where he says, you know, I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. And it's just a real sad state of affairs. And, you know, that's the world that we find ourselves in, where the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. Because you've got to think, Paul, you know, you think back in, you know, it's almost like nothing has changed, where the laborers are few. All the way back in Paul's day, where, you know, that was the closest to when Jesus rose again, the miracles, the things that the apostles did, you'd think that, hey, Christianity just must be booming, right? But when Paul is deciding to send somebody to go help the Philippians, what does he say? He goes, I've got nobody else. I've got no man like-minded, right? The only people he has to send is Timotheus, who is catering to his wants, and Epaphroditus, somebody who's sick, who almost died, right? Sent to Philippi. And you kind of got to ask the question, well, where was everybody else? Where was all the able-minded people? Where were all the young men and women in their prime, not sick? You know, we know Timothy later on, he had sickness as well. He had to take a bit of wine for his stomach's sake. What were they all doing, right? Well, you know, all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. So we don't want to be that, right? And that's the same, you know, today. You know, people, they seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. And that's why the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. And we see that here. And it's a sad state of affairs that, you know, where were these people? You know, where are the people that are going to put their hand up to serve Jesus Christ? So I know I was talking about unity, but I just thought this is a real great passage where we see that Paul wanted the Philippians to strive for unity. Say, you know, they needed to love one another, they needed to be humble, they needed to strive, and gave us these four examples of people. Well, Paul gave us three examples, but we see Paul obviously as an example too of the sort of character that we ought to strive for and the people we ought to hold in reputation. And yeah, it's a challenging thing, right? It's a challenging thing to read how selfless these people were and to reflect on your own life and think, man, I am... You know, if you ever think, if there's ever a time where you think I've arrived, this is the sort of chapter that just puts you back in your place, right? And just says, you know what, I'm so selfish. I'm not, and this is how we renew our mind, right? Because one of the things we got to renew is to think how good we are, right? We think that we're all that. We think we're the gift, you know, God's gift to the world. No, you know, we come short and we are constantly striving forward. And that's why the Word of God is a good reminder for us to not seek our own. Remember why we're here on this earth, you know, to win souls, to love one another, to be a light, and don't let the world carry you away from that. All right. Amen. All right, let's pray, and then I'll just go through some announcements. Thank you, Lord, for your Word. Thank you for the reminder for us to strive for unity. Lord, it's going to take love. It's going to take the mind of Christ for us to humble ourselves and love one another. Pray, Lord, that we would not seek our own, but seek the things of you. That, Lord, you know, in this church, it would not be like in Paul's day where he had no man like-minded to help in the work. Help us, Lord, to serve you and love you. And, Lord, it's our reasonable service. We pray that you'd help us and love you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.